Thanks for joining us today. We're going to wait just a little bit for the room to fill up. We'll wait just another moment or two and then we'll get started. We're just waiting for folks to trickle in. Looks like about half of our participants that registered have joined. We'll give them just another minute or two and we'll get started. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Doug Weiss and I'm the Director of Technology at Henderson, and I'm going to be your moderator today. I've been on many panels and moderated a few, never done it virtually, so hang with us today and we're going to give you some great information. Here at Henderson since 2018, we've been involved in the design of more than 250 million square feet of warehouse facilities. And just this year alone, in 8 months, we've worked on about as many warehouse projects in that time as we have in the last 2 years combined. If you provided your AI number when you registered, we're going to, and you complete it today, you're going to get your credits automatically updated by Henderson. If not, everybody who remains on the call is going to get a certificate of completion, and then you can self-report. Here are the course descriptions, learning objectives. I'm not going to read these to you, but essentially what we're going to talk about today is how the rapidly changing warehouse market is impacting all of our business. And now I'm going to let our panelists, the folks that are leading our efforts in this area, are going to introduce themselves and tell you what they do.
Hey everyone, I'm Tony Welter. I am our grocery practice director and I've been here for 19 years. I'm actually substituting for Justin Harvey. He's our warehouse practice director and he had to be out this week because of personal family matters. So I'm happy to substitute for him. Justin and I have been working closely together about the last 2 years since there's been so much overlap between a grocery and warehouse. And so it was a good fit. Of those 250 million square foot that Doug talked about, I looked and we had done 775 projects. And I think our team or the team that I'm in with the grocery practice has done roughly a third of those. And so I'm happy to share with some of the things I know today.
I am Jen Jewers-Bolin. I am a lead program manager on a warehouse and grocery team. I've been at Henderson for over 13 years and I've worked closely with Tony for all 13 of those years. I started off doing refrigeration engineering design for supermarkets, transitioned into project management, and now into program management as well as larger project management for some of our larger warehouse projects, and still do a little bit on the refrigeration side as well. So.
Hi, good afternoon. I am Chris Kalp. I'm the Director of Fire and Life Safety here at Henderson. I have kind of overall responsibilities for anything fire protection here at the company, including warehouse design. Between our three groups, our commercial design, our co-consulting folks, and our program folks, we do quite a bit of warehouse work and hope to be able to share some of those experiences with you today.
So, as many of you know, warehouse and distribution facility needs, requirements were blooming even before the pandemic. Mostly that was driven by some of the largest retailers in the world choosing to focus on direct to consumer delivery. And from that, it becomes a circle where consumers began demanding next day, same day delivery from other retailers, dragging them along for the ride. So these consumer expectations are driving the need, as well as driving the need for increased automation, closer last mile delivery facilities, and greater demand in general for distribution square footage. On top of this already growing demand, obviously we have the pandemic, which is driving more and more customers out of the brick and mortar stores, even grocery, and onto online purchasing and direct to home delivery. Tony, talk to us a little bit about what distribution looks like today compared to what it looked like, say, 15, 20, 30 years ago.
Sure, Doug. So the warehouses of today are seeing upgrades for many different reasons, and we're seeing that impact on the design. So Henderson designs, construction manages, and commissions the mechanical, electrical, plumbing, refrigeration, fire protection, and technology infrastructure, and that's basically what we're going to be talking through today. So Henderson also collaborates with many incredible architects, structural engineers, contractors, and probably the most importantly, owners, to make the project successful. So the first thing that I'm seeing a lot of is more warehouses are directly serving customers. And so when we're doing that, we're calling them fulfillment centers. We're doing micro fulfillment centers, we're doing medium fulfillment centers, and we're doing giant fulfillment centers. So in the past, a grocery or retail world existed to serve another warehouse or a grocery or retail store. Obviously, that's still happening with retail and grocery, but there's a lot more growth in the direct from warehouse to customer in a fulfillment setting. So in that, you know, with the growth of that, the warehouses in desired cities are often not built for the new needs or purposes of the clients. So many tenant improvements are needed to be made. Kind of the second thing that I've seen a lot of is warehouse employee comfort. So, you know, many of the older warehouses that had louvers and fans, and that was enough to do the process that, or the delivery that we needed to do from that warehouse. Now, many of the newer warehouses are requiring by their the owners to have more comfort for their employees. And then the products inside them are more expensive because we're delivering them directly to the customer. So if it's food or, you know, high-end electronics, we want integrity for that product. And then the third thing that I'm seeing is technology. So technology to make everything automatic, to make everything faster, is being driven all across the warehouse industry. So this includes upgraded technology for conveyors, robots, anything to make the picking process quicker. We did a project with a client earlier last year, and it basically had a robots picking the food and the regular products just from a stand. And so it basically, they enter the order from the end of the row, and you'll see some pictures later in the presentation, but it then the product went back to the actual picker, and they didn't even need to do anything except for enter the order and then deliver it to the driver for fulfillment. So even if clients are handpicking, they're still planning on how to increase the efficiency. So I guess in all this, it's important to bring in engineering and design early on in the design process to facilitate the owner and tenant's needs and the requirements from a building system standpoint, as well as utility infrastructure standpoint. So many times the landlord or developer is willing to share the cost of upgrades if the client knows what their needs may be at the time of the build out or handover. So our first involvement then is usually a site validation and looking at the landlord letter. So our team goes through the vetting process, the property or the existing structure. Our team helps in a go or no go process, reviewing the landlord letter and perhaps even providing RM costs to the clients to see what upgrades may be needed. So here's some things we look for across mechanical, electrical, plumbing. Mechanical, I mentioned a lot of the existing sites we're going to don't have equipment, but if they do, if it's a new site and they do have equipment, we wanna make sure the tonnage and condition we can reuse. If we're gonna add new equipment, can the structure hold it? Where can the new equipment go? Can it go on the ground? Is there space around the site? If we have old equipment, Can we demo it? How do we demo it? Electrical, the biggest thing there is service size. So we're oftentimes, because we're adding mechanical, and Jen's going to cover here in a little bit, refrigeration, the service size can increase immensely. So getting that coordinated early can be a big piece in getting your project complete in a timely manner. Lighting fixtures, when we get there, what are they producing? Foot candles at the floor? Is it going to meet the needs of the client? So plumbing, some of the things we do is we map out existing entrance of plumbing and sizes. So are we going to be able to place the bathroom, break rooms, et cetera, where the owner wants them without too much work? We had a site that we went to last year that they had a plumbing easement going through the entire building. And so when they had that plumbing easement, we worked with the architect and the client, and you know, we tried to place all the equipment around the easement, and we ended up being a no-go on the project because we couldn't make that work. So those are kind of things when we see a site that we want to know. Plumbing, with another thing we look at is the flow test. So are we going to need a domestic pump? You know, can we serve the fixtures way across a large warehouse with the existing pressure that we got? I'm going to kick it over to Chris for fire protection.
Yeah, thanks, Tony. Certainly that flow test is really important for the fire protection side as well, because we want to make sure we have adequate water supply for the sprinkler system. Sometimes the existing systems might be a little short on water if the flow test comes back and maybe the water system is degraded. The other thing, if a lot of no-go decisions are made, is based upon the type of sprinkler system installed. It has to really fit, and we'll get into that a little bit later on, what the client is looking for. So something, if you're just going in and doing a quick look, you're looking for an ESFR, early separation fast response sprinkler system, if at all possible. We want to avoid those systems that don't have a hydraulic placard or don't have a label of in terms of exactly what is present in the system. If you see something that says ordinary hazard, or there's just no placard at all or no information, probably not the best fit for most warehouse installs. Jen, can you tell us a little bit about refrigeration, no go, no go?
Sure. Thanks, Chris. So a couple of things that we're looking at are, what's the R value of the roof? If there's at least an R30 R value of the roof, we'll be able to use that as a box lid for some of our walk-in spaces. And what's the existing structural capacity of the roof, as well as the joists and girders? Much of the refrigeration equipment that would be needed to chill or freeze the spaces is heavy. Even an evaporator that's hanging in a walk-in box can be on the order of 3,000 pounds or more. So if we can support the equipment without adding a lot of structural steel, then that's something we're interested in and looking at. Where the refrigeration system and its associated components can go. Is there space exterior, interior? Just there's some place that we can locate the equipment. And then where's the facility overall located at? Do we have location and access to service technicians to service our equipment?
Thanks, Jen. I'm going to go off script here a little bit and apologize. I made an omission earlier. Hopefully it hasn't impacted anyone yet, but chat is disabled, but we encourage you to use the Q&A feature. We're going to get these experts to dive a lot deeper as we go farther into the presentation. So there may be questions that come up. Please put them in chat. We're going to try and answer as many as we can live. But if we don't get to them, we will send out any answers we give live, as well as answer any unanswered questions. So I apologize for missing that earlier. Jen, hopping back to you, it seems like there's the number of systems we have to consider a lot more than years past. Can you talk a little bit more about what it means to have a refrigerated cold storage in a warehouse?
Sure. So it's kind of important to start at the top that refrigeration systems are custom. They're individually designed for each site. You can't go to a manufacturer, to a book or a program, and just pick a site, kind of like you can with some of the mechanical rooftop equipment or other things. They're not off the shelf. And so we work closely with our end users, and then, you know, our architectural, structural, electrical, mechanical partners to make sure that what we're designing for the site, you know, works for all parties involved. So you have multiple refrigerant and system types for options. You can look at doing a packaged system or a plant system. So packaged systems come put together at the manufacturer's facility, and then they'll ship them to the site, like on the back of a semi flatbed trailer. The plant systems, they ship the individual components to the site. And then they're put together, connected by the contractor into your overall system. Your refrigerant types could be a direct expansion with a traditional HFC refrigerant, carbon dioxide, such as a carbon dioxide cascade or secondary system, and then ammonia systems as well. Service concerns come into play when you decide to put in a refrigeration system. As I previously mentioned, do you have availability of skilled technicians? If you're in a very rural area, that could limit your skilled technicians if there aren't a lot of other refrigerated warehouses or refrigerated systems there. So that may drive, or that will drive, the refrigeration system and refrigerant that you're choosing. If you're in an urban area, then you're likely able to choose anything that works for your site and your client's wishes. Structural integrity. The weight of the refrigeration equipment is heavier than many people think. So are we having a well thought out space? Can the roof handle the weight of the equipment? Even if the refrigeration system equipment is not roof mounted, there will be evaporators in the chilled spaces that are going to be hung from joists and girders. If you have a chilled space that is lower than 32 degrees, so often a meat or a protein box or any kind of freezer space, then you're not going to use the roof as the box lid in those situations. You've got to have an internal box lid that hangs or is often supported from the joists and girders there. And so can the structural handle that support without adding any extra structural support to what's already there? We also have plumbing concerns. Similar to mechanical rooftop equipment, evaporators have condensate discharge, and that water discharge has to go somewhere. It's headed to sanitary. Often in some of the older buildings, there may just be sanitary on one side of the building or one corner of the building. So can we tear up the floor and get the sanitary line over there? Can we put in some sort of pump to pump it back to where the sanitary system is? Then there are exterior components to the refrigeration systems. Many of them have a water-cooled evaporator or an adiabatic unit that also has water to it. So where's the water service to the building? Is it adequate for the flow that we're going to need for this, in addition to water for the rest of the building and fire protection systems? If the facility has what they call a wet produce room, so whether you're doing misters there or the produce is coming in on ice, or you have ice at the facility to pack it down, you'll need some sort of trench drain to collect the meltage or the discharge off of that and then head that back into your sanitary system as well. Then you have cold dock. So this is different from your ambient dock in that you want to physically separate the space through walls and other methods. So some of the things that we're looking at there that we work closely with, like our architectural partners and structural partners, to make sure happen would be a continuous pit. And then dock doors, that there are dock door packages specific for cold docks that are different from your ambient dock and the rest of the space. These would have insulated doors, vertical storing dock levelers, dock seals, and dock curtains. Those vertical dock leveler doors and the rest of the systems will protect the product cold chain and preserve that cold dock environment. You want to make sure that when your tri-temp or refrigerated truck backs up into the space and is sealed at the dock door, that you are not disrupting the integrity of the cold product, whether it's product coming in or product going out, and that you're not sending your chilled air out to the atmosphere or bringing in hot, humid air if it's the middle of summer somewhere. We're also looking at durability. Oftentimes, forklifts are in use in a warehouse space, so you need to protect your equipment, whether it's your insulated metal panels, your cooler walls, from being damaged by forklifts running into it. Evaporators, if a forklift is driving around with the product or a pallet extended up, you don't want it to bang into your evaporator. And any other equipment, there are control panels or other electrical panels in the space. Anything on the floor, such as a drain cover, needs to be able to withstand heavy forklift traffic going over it if it's in the flow of traffic. And then your doors. In addition to wanting energy efficient doors that can withstand the operating temperatures of the space, they're undergoing frequent openings. They're in a freezer, they could be heated. The forklift's driving through it, not just the actual doors opening and closing, and so that they're able to withstand the multiple uses over a potential 24-hour cycle each day. Very important to refrigerated space in a warehouse is both the thermal envelope and the vapor barriers. So I previously mentioned that having an R30 cooler box lid is a bonus when we're looking at an existing warehouse space, an R30 roof lid. So if the roof is at least an insulated value of R30, this will save the tenant or the client money, you can use that roof lid as the box of coolers as long as the space, the refrigerated space, is over 32 degrees instead of having to have what we call a box-in-box system. But you're still going to end up breaking that thermal barrier, even if that is the roof of your box. So the integrity of our thermal envelope is critical. Things like columns, the need for doors so people and things can go in and out, refrigerant pipes, fire protection pipes, all of those can break the thermal continuity. So to mitigate that, we take great care in detailing exactly how that thermal envelope is broken, have a broad knowledge of the insulated products available, and then understand how building codes are applied to refrigerated spaces. Just as important as the walls or the roof of refrigerated spaces is the floor. And so when you're looking at refrigerated spaces that are going to be below 32 degrees, you want to protect the floor from the soil underneath and from the soil warming and cooling and freezing. So you're looking at a heated floor slab. Two common ways that that's done is through a glycol underfloor warming system. So we'll use heat reclaim, usually off of the refrigeration system, and send a glycol loop over to a manifold and then send that into small pipes that overlap and loop each other under the floor to keep that above freezing. Or on smaller boxes, you can also do this with electric heat. Once that's down and in, you'll have floor insulation between the floor warming system and the building floor slab. Typically, if you had a minus 10 degree space, then you're going to look at a minimum of 6 inches of insulation between the floor warming system and the floor slab for that insulation. And then the vapor envelope is also critical. So vapor is water, and in cold storage facilities, water is ice, and ice means damage. You'll see in the pictures up on the slide some of the things that can happen when you get vapor into a refrigerated system, especially one below freezing. A properly designed vapor barrier coupled with the thermal envelope will protect your building, protect your product, and protect the equipment located inside of it.
Jen, I know you've got a couple more points for us, but I did want to ask for the audience, you spent a lot of time talking about the importance of the roof, but what if you can't build on the roof? What does that mean?
Thanks, Doug. So if you can't build on the roof, then that means a couple of things. One, that for any refrigerated box that you're putting in, it will have its own box lid inside of the space. And it also means that your refrigeration equipment can't be located on the box or on the roof. So you're looking at locating the equipment either inside the building. I think I previously mentioned that ammonia systems usually go inside the building. And so you're either carving out space from the existing warehouse or you're building an enclosed space right next to the warehouse for the plant. Adjacent to that, you will need an exterior location for the condenser that goes with the ammonia system. Or you can do this with a package system as well. It could be inside the building and it would also have an exterior condenser next to it. Or you can put it on the ground for packaged equipment outside of the building. A couple of things to note, if you're putting it on the outside of the building exterior, depending on the layout of your building, you're going to try to minimize. You don't want to take up any dock door space. That could decrease your capability and capacity of the facility later. But you also need to make sure that that equipment is protected, both from potential vandals, but also from accidentally being backed into, by a truck that's maybe backing into a dock space if it's adjacent to that. So you're going to want to surround it with bollards or other large equipment protection, and then a fence or some sort of gated structure to protect someone from walking up and vandalizing the equipment. We also work closely with the electrical team when you're adding refrigeration to a warehouse facility. The refrigeration equipment has a hefty electrical load. When you compare it to a warehouse that's non-refrigerated of the same size, you're looking at anywhere from 5 to 10 times the load of a non-refrigerated warehouse. Depending on the size of your facility, this also means that you're looking at adding 1 to 2 electrical services. Everything that you have in the building, from the equipment to the product, but it's really the product inside, is expensive if you have a power loss. So one of the things that we recommend is adding in a backup generator. If the service, electrical service, goes down, depending on the duration and then your current ambient conditions outside, there's less of a concern, if the power goes out in the middle of a Chicago winter versus a thunderstorm that comes through in Houston in the middle of July or August. But depending on the ambient conditions and the duration of the loss, you could lose all of the product in your box. We've had clients where this is on order of tens of thousands of dollars up to $1 million in product loss. So adding a backup generator to any service that is serving the refrigeration equipment will help mitigate this risk. If you are adding refrigeration to an existing electrical service and you want to add a backup generator to that, then we would recommend that you look at bringing on a commissioning agent like our partners at Henderson Building Solutions. That commissioning agent will come in and make sure that the generator is brought online properly and that it's working as designed to ensure that your product and your building is protected. We also work closely with the HVAC and mechanical designers, as there are effects, the ambient space affects the refrigeration design and the space. We need conditioned air. I talked before about water being bad in a refrigerated space. So you want to make sure that you're not having high humidity in the ambient side of your building. Otherwise, that humid air is going to flow right into the refrigerated side and the refrigeration equipment will have to work harder to keep up with that.
Thanks, Jen. That's great. I appreciate the information. I think next we're going to have Tony talk a little bit about some different building systems, less specific as a refrigerated warehouse space.
I'm going to start with mechanical. So like I said earlier, a lot of the sites that we go to, we see the bare minimums with louvers and fans. We still do that design on lower level warehouses, but many of the buildings that we're working on now are requiring air conditioning, or as Jen was just talking about, humidity control. So adding air conditioning for employee comfort and humidity control for cold storage adds a lot of capacity not originally intended. In addition, air movement is important with large volumes of space and racking to block the air movement. So with the taller automated systems of racking, we may perform a computational fluid dynamic analysis to ensure the airflow gets throughout or where we want it to get to throughout the building. And as Jen was talking about, one of the ways besides an envelope that we can get that humidity and the moisture out of the refrigerated boxes is to add humidity control. We're seeing active humidity control being added to many of the cold storage spaces that we are working on. So another thing, as I mentioned earlier, many warehouses are now being used as fulfillment centers. This means instead of only having trucks back up and pick up or drop off at a dock door, delivery drivers are now coming into the site. So this could mean something as simple as delivery drivers park outside and then they walk in the front door and come pick up the products that they need to fulfill. Or with a much bigger impact, the fulfillment drivers are driving into the building to pick up the packages they need to fulfill, or through drive-through canopies to load their vehicles. So each one of these items creates a set of design challenges as the mechanical needs to process the vehicle emissions if the vehicles are inside and the CO2 that's created, or heat the areas in the canopies as the cars go through the delivery line, and account for the air infiltration as it's coming into the building. So the other thing we see is added heat loads from the equipment inside. So any kind of sortation equipment, conveyance, robotics, and different types of equipment add heat load that would normally not be there if you just had pallet racks and stacking. So the addition of this new technology makes tons per square foot rule of thumb calculations almost obsolete. So in the last thing on mechanical, 2020 kind of added to our design issues is infection control. So we're starting to add more filtration for HVAC to mitigate some of the infection spread. UV lights, we're adding more air changes than we normally would have all to create a better environment for the employees there. And then just floor plan wise, I mean, we're seeing bigger offices, greater spaces and break rooms, walk pass through, and each one of those changes and causes the HVAC to change with it. Electrical, Jen kind of gave us the biggest case scenario with a refrigerated warehouse. And those warehouses, you know, we can see upwards of 16,000 amps. And so many of the sites that we take over or work on, they're just not ready for 16,000 amps when you come in. In fact, I don't think any site we could find would have that there. But we see, you know, sites as low as 400 if we don't have refrigeration. We have louvers and fans like we're talking about. But most of the time it's in between 400 and 800, and we're talking at 460 volts. And so in order to upgrade, we want to make sure that we coordinate with utilities early. The utilities are usually slower in getting the upgrades. And so we want to make sure that's one of the first things we do when we're doing a design is look at what we need to upgrade and where that entrance is going to be. Some of the other things we're looking at is lighting level. So building heights are going up. There's a picture on the screen there, and you can kind of see that the lighting has changed inside of the warehouse. So most of our clients are looking for higher foot candles so they can do their processes that they need, or if their, you know, equipment need lighting. So each one of those places has a different lighting need. And so knowing what those needs are at the individual spaces and then designing for is very important. And Jen covered this a little bit too, but I wanted to bring it up with the electrical generator. And so we're seeing, on our cold storage, we definitely fully back up in a lot of our sites. And because, like Jen mentioned, you have millions of dollars of food on site. And so if you have one incident, it basically pays for what you're installing as a backup. You know, with those, you have automatic transfer switches to run them seamlessly if you have a power outage. So the secondary thing we do would be, you know, to partial backup. And so you would only do emergency or critical part. So if you're doing a cold storage, you might just do the refrigeration. Or if you have products that are more expensive in your site that you want to keep running, you would just do those. And then the third thing that we see is quick connects. And so that would be, you don't have space for a generator on site. It's a multi-story warehouse. There's no place outside or on the roof for it, or it's just an easier way to make that coordination. And so those quick connects rely on an outside service to get their power back up. So if the power goes down, you call the outside service, they come and quick connect to the system, and that gets you back up and running. The only thing we're kind of seeing with the infection control and electrical, and it makes sense, is touchless sensors. So light switchers are kind of a thing of the past in those situations anyway, but anywhere where we could have a sensor or electrical and make it touchless, that's what we're wanting to go to. And the last thing I'm gonna cover today is the plumbing. So I got a good picture of a urinal here for you, but so service size and pressure with the water, gas, and sanitary is kind of the biggest thing we look at the beginning. So I mentioned like the domestic pump and the pressure with the water coming in. So lots of times we're having to go 300-400 feet across a warehouse. And even in smaller warehouses, we want to know if we can use wall hung, you know, fixtures, or if we have to have tank types. Gas is the same way. Do we have enough pressure? A lot of the older sites that we go into, you might have to size your pipe for lower pressure. And, you know, or if we could use higher pressure, we can have smaller pipes. Sanitary, the biggest thing with sanitary is knowing what your invert is. So invert in plumbing speak is how far down under the ground the sanitary pipe connects into the city system. So when you use a break room sink on the other side or a bathroom set on the other side of the building, it has to slope all the way to that site. So we've had plenty of projects where we've had to add lift pumps, or we had to add a new sanitary line across or outside the building. So just knowing where that is and what how deep it is in the actual ground to see if, you know, we have to make any modifications there. So, and the other part with the sanitary is we've done a lot of warehouses and multi-story buildings. So just knowing how to coordinate that plumbing through multiple floors, it becomes a complication if you have a tenant underneath. We had a site with a Bed Bath & Beyond right underneath it. And so obviously they didn't want our plumbing coming down right into their Bed Bath & Beyond. So just coordinating with the building that you're in is, you know, like we do with any building, but with warehouses, it's kind of a bigger deal because it's hard to move some of those spaces. And then the last thing I want to cover is the prep areas. Do we have any wet produce? Are we gonna need trench drains in there? Do we have any commercial kitchens? We've done lots of warehouses where they do food delivery. And so commercial kitchens have a grease interceptor. Even if you have just a simple prep area, you're gonna have a 3-compartment sink, and you're gonna have to coordinate a grease interceptor or grease trap And that's just a separate coordination than the sanitary. And then the last thing I want to mention is condensate pumps and drains. So when we do our cold storage that I was talking about, we work on, we want to know if we have to pump that condensate across the building or if we're going to have drains underneath it. So Doug, I know you're moderating today, but if you could cover the technology piece, that would be great.
Sure. Happy to do it, Tony. Thanks. So one thing I want to just start with is Henderson is not an expert in automated logistics. We are experts in providing the services that they need to be successful, whether that's power, cooling, data, water, whatever that might be. That is our expertise. And in my realm, what we need is, excellent connectivity. And these are obviously, especially in automated warehouse, these are highly complex environments. There are a lot of moving pieces and parts in multiple dimensions, not just two dimensions. So the things that we're focusing on are the placement of what we call an IDF, which is just a technology cabinet where we have network switches that would connect to the different devices, whether it's Wi-Fi, IP-enabled security cameras, those sorts of things, data connectivity, as well as the pathway to get from a central point, what we call an MDF, to those IDFs. And we focus very closely on those three dimensions because, as Chris mentioned in a different Tony mentioned in a different context, that plumbing all needs to slope. So typically in a building, plumbing and fire protection goes first. We got to move the water. Then we have big mechanical systems. We've got fans. We've got conveyor systems, conveyance systems. So it's really important that we protect that pathway. Just like Jen mentioned with putting bollards around mechanical equipment, we need to make sure that these systems and components that are critical to the effectiveness of the building are protected. Another thing we're seeing more of, and it's something that the folks on our HVAC side deal with, is a lot of these robotic systems run off capacitors and they eject a lot of heat into the environment. So that's another thing they're considering. One thing that we're seeing more and more of is these facilities, especially at the last mile, are supporting local delivery vehicles. And some of those are electric vehicles or hybrids. And so we need to consider how we're going to charge those. And that's very important to many of our customers who have goals to become carbon neutral or net zero. Finally, we have to consider recharging robotic systems inside the building. We need to think about the total size of the building, where our electrical distribution panels are, how many robotic pieces do we have? Are we going to cluster them to charge in groups? Spread those out throughout the facility. So that's just something we want to understand with the owner and work out the best solution with the owner and the architect to make sure we have a viable solution. On the loss prevention side, really not much has changed except in using these systems to help fight the pandemic. So there are some things that we can do. Many of our existing IP-enabled security cameras, for instance, today, they have a temperature sensing function. So it could potentially identify somebody that's warmer than they ought to be. The other thing we can do linked with access control, we can try and control, make an indoor and an outdoor, for instance. We can do that both with an access control system only recognizing a credential going one way. But we also have technology and video analytics from the camera, and they can actually detect someone moving the wrong way within a virtually defined space. So there are some things we're looking at and can help with in that way. And that's really the big thing, is just more connectivity, more Wi-Fi, making sure that it's all protected and providing the support that the automated logistics systems need. Chris, from that discussion of technology, you lead our fire protection life safety team, one of the biggest in the country. Tell us a little bit about what it takes to protect these buildings.
Yeah, thanks, Doug. Unfortunately, warehouses, we seem to have a lot of them in the news in the recent past. We've had a lot of fires that kind of plague the industry. And these are typically, they make the news because they're pretty large loss fires and in some cases explosions. And, these things generally, these fires result from the fire protection is not matched to either the commodity, and that's the stuff you're storing and the stuff that burns, or it's not matched to the storage configuration in which it's being located, such as the racks or the shelves or the pallets. So we have to continuously think about how do we need to properly protect it. I mentioned before, you know, you don't want to walk into a warehouse as a spec warehouse maybe and soar really high if it's an ordinary hazard building. It just won't protect it. And it's not even enough to be a sprinkler building with ESFR sprinklers sometimes. It just isn't going to be sufficient to control every single scenario. So you have to be thinking about things, as you mentioned, Doug, the robotics. You have to think about fire starting to arson. You have to think about, you know, malfunctioning equipment. You have to think about product that might be stacked a little too high and it's a little too close to that unit heater and it catches on fire from above. And in some cases, you might have a fire that's very small, maybe even in a trash can, but people don't realize that it's there and they move too slowly and they can't get the small fire suppressed before it catches onto something else and grows. So yeah, you're right. There's a lot to think about. You know, in most locations too, it's not just to worry about the large losses. We actually have to think about what do we need to do to open those facilities, because these educated fire departments, they know about warehouse. They know about warehouse protection and what it takes to do it. And they're tuned into those causes of those big devastating total loss fires, and they want to prevent that. So they're going to require you to be properly matched by design. And they're also going to require that those facilities are being properly maintained. You know, are the valves being exercised? Are the switches, the monitoring switches on the valves and on the flow switches, are they being tested and monitored properly? Are the notification appliances for the fire alarm system, such as the horn strobes, are they working? What about your pumps? What about water storage tanks? Are they being tested and exercised? And are those being logged properly? So there's a lot more that goes into warehouse than the typical run-of-the-mill facility.
Chris, it seems pretty obvious that those fire protection equipment needs to be maintained as well or better as any other, say, mechanical piece of equipment in the building. What are some things that a fire protection do that maybe aren't so obvious to help our owners, architects, developers, contractors? What can you and your team do to help? What can a fire protection engineer do to help?
Sure. Thanks, Doug. Good question. So the most frequent things we see when we're helping clients with a new warehouse or moving into a spec is that usually these buildings are designed around a certain type of storage. And the client that wants to work with us may have a different kind of storage. Let's just say that a lot of things we're seeing with automation these days, they want to use plastic totes or they want to use a tote that might have no lid on it. And those don't work in a typical spec warehouse that's designed for carton storage. Plastic totes are more combustible product. So we have to specify some different protections for that. Sometimes we have clients that want to stack their product on racks, which is great. Open frame racks are wonderful for stacking. That's a good thing from a fire protection standpoint. But they might want to stack those things so close together that it creates what we call a solid shelf rack. And in that case, then you have to add in-rack sprinklers. We have to kind of consult with the clients and let them know, okay, you have to space those apart, or we'll go ahead and design those in-rack sprinklers. Something else that's really important is that ESFR sprinklers, I've mentioned those several times now. There's a reason. A lot of warehouses have them, but they cannot be used on every type of commodity. You have to know exactly what's going to be in that facility. And the best example I can give is the combustible or flammable liquid. ESFR sprinklers are not listed for that. They're also not listed without in racks to be used on those solid shelf rack storage configurations. So we have to use very specific protection methods, either from NFPA or from different testing, insurance standards or whatnot. Or we can use a performance-based design where we do a full-scale fire test and confirm that a protection scheme works for what they want to do. Something else to be considered is travel distance. A lot of times we'll move into a large facility. You know, these are big facilities in many cases. And the racking configuration creates dead ends. And those dead ends can affect what we call the maximum travel distance. And we have to compare that travel distance to the maximum allowable to make sure that people can egress in case of an emergency. So we have to really look at those distances and be sure that we're not exceeding them. We mentioned computational fluid dynamics before. We will employ those same ideas, different software with the same ideas, and we can use CFD to model a fire. and we can model how long it would take a smoke layer or a deadly smoke layer to build up in a space. And we can compute how much time it takes that to happen versus how long it takes to egress. So there's a lot of different things that we can do to help our clients get what they want or get what they need in order to be successful. You know, the last thing I wanted to mention was we talked about water supply before. Well, a lot of times these facilities are going in locations that the water supply is not strong, and we need very, very strong water supplies for warehouses. So many times we'll have a fire pump installed in a facility. Well, if this is a really important facility, we might want to have two fire pumps, create redundancy. And we also might want to have water storage tanks installed so that we can ensure that water supply will be there at all times, no matter what happens with your public water supply. Back to ESFR sprinklers. I've written some articles that appear in the Plumbing Engineer magazine, and I think we can send those out after the fact via email to those who are on the call, that really talk about the kind of the do's and don'ts of ESFR sprinklers, kind of bust some of the myths about it. It's really important to know that these are not one size fits all solutions to storage. No matter what anybody may tell you, a building owner say, well, I have ESFR sprinklers, you can do anything you want. That's not true. There's limitations on the products, there's limitations on your storage height, and there's limitations on the ceiling height to which you can use these sprinklers. They are fantastic sprinklers, don't get me wrong, but they just don't solve every possible condition out there. Just for fun, I took a picture of a few different sprinklers from my collection and put them side by side. And I thought it might be kind of fun to do a little quiz here. Are we giving out prizes for anybody who gets it right? I don't know.
We can send them the link to those magazine articles.
Hey, there you go. Yeah, that sounds good. So a little quiz here. There's six sprinklers shown in this photo. Can you guess which two are actually the ESFR sprinklers? Give people a moment to kind of guess. There you go. So only two of the six are ESFR. And what I think is really interesting, and I have one of those right in front of me here, it's the smallest one in the picture is an ESFR sprinkler. So just because you might think you know what you're looking for, it really does take a true professional in fire protection to be able to identify what's in a building and to make sure that it's appropriate for you.
Thanks, Chris. I knew the answer today because we talked about it when we practiced, but I would have never guessed the smallest sprinkler head was an ESFR when we first started doing this. Any other surprises about warehouse fire protection?
Yeah, sure. There's quite a few things. And, you know, we've been talking about automation quite a bit today, and this was probably not a surprise so much as an obvious thing, but the move toward automation is really changing the industry, and the fire protection industry is absolutely no different. We're seeing a lot of issues with automated storage, and because what you have to think about there is what happens when you have a fire normally in a non-automated facility. The fire grows vertically. We know where it's going to be. The fire is going to be right there where it started or above it. It's just going to grow vertically. It will spread eventually horizontally, but not very fast. Robotics changes everything, and it can literally carry a fire from the origin anywhere in a facility. And that has happened so many times. A big fire in Europe with this facility, it was a total loss, as you can imagine with a fire that massive as shown in the photo here. We have to think about how to stop that from spreading. So it's really creating a lot of change in my industry in terms of what do we need to do. So for example, what we've done in a couple of facilities is to incorporate aspirating smoke detection systems that can detect fires literally before they start, while it's still just a smoldering fire, not even smoke. And it can detect those things very early. And then we combine that with the automation systems to stop the robots from moving, and then our sprinkler systems have a chance to work. They can actually maybe stop that fire and prevent these total losses. Unfortunately, the cost of all these systems is a lot more. And Tony mentioned before, or I think it was Tony that said, you know, the old rules of thumb about dollar per foot, those are just completely out the window. The cost for these systems are pretty high. And the tenants, and you need to think about moving in and just taking over facility may not be feasible. We might have to do some upgrades or add some partitioning. You know, those do add a lot of cost to the facilities. You know, it's really important. I think it's important to get fire protection involved early in the process. Years past, maybe you could design your box. I say the box, the simple building. You could design it, get your MEP all figured out, know where the air handlers are, figure out where the transformer is, and you're done. And then the fire guy says, here's your design, easy. That's not really true anymore. It's really important that we coordinate all of the fire protection needs up front, that we have those conversations with the clients very early on, because it's going to reduce surprises. We don't want to surprise people with fire pumps and water storage tanks. That's expensive. And then we also can coordinate with our other friends in the other trades. We can coordinate our sprinklers with our duct, with our structure, with our lights, and make sure that everything's going to fit in really nicely. And oh, by the way, we need to make it fit with the automation and the storage itself so that it's as economical as possible. I did mention that technology is changing, and you know, the fire protection industry is catching up. There's more and more tests being run. There's more and more being understood about what we can do to knock out fire before it grows and becomes a total loss. But sometimes, you know, the only solution we have is to do a burn test and see exactly what the storage configuration is, do a burn test and make sure that what we put in will work. Sometimes it's really the only way to do it. This new technology, the last mile delivery, all these things are really changing how we protect buildings. We just had a situation where a client that only wants to store to 8 feet, just 8 feet in a big warehouse, it was going to result in really massive changes to the system because of that storage configuration. And, you know, it's like we say, you know, even the simple stuff, warehouse, simple stuff, it ain't simple anymore. It just isn't simple anymore.
Thanks, Chris. Thanks, Jen. Thanks, Tony. Appreciate it. We've got a few minutes left in our hour, so we're going to pop to some Q&A, and I'm going to toss these out. Let's see. And as I mentioned earlier, we'll do a summary of all these answers as well as answer any questions we don't get to with follow-up to you after the webinar is over. Chris, I think this is for you. What are the sprinkler requirements when you have hanging or hanging conveyor clothing racks? Are additional sprinklers needed?
Great question. Are additional sprinklers needed? We have designed some systems. I don't know if they mean moving racks or stationary, but we have designed some systems with movable racks that did not use additional sprinklers. We did use some other technology coupled with the sprinklers and coupled with the automation of those movable racks to stop the clothing. There is a design standard that would work without additional sprinklers, or with additional sprinklers, but we did something more, I guess you could say, more engineered that did not use additional sprinklers. So don't always need that.
Great. I think next is Jen for you. What are some common rules of thumb of when the floor needs to be heated? Parenthetically, climate zone, comma, dimension, size of refrigerated space, temperature refrigerated space, etc.
So in a warehouse facility, refrigerated warehouse situation, we would recommend that it get, that you heat the floor anytime that the space, the temperature inside the box is under 32 degrees Fahrenheit, if it's below freezing. The reason is the soil contains moisture, so it's critical that the freezer floor gets separated from the soil. If that doesn't happen over time, the temperature of the freezer is going to transmit through the floor slab. Eventually, the soil will be at the same temperature of the freezer. When that happens, then the soil is going to freeze and expand and create an ice lens, which will result in those heaved floor slabs that I mentioned earlier, as well as some building foundation and column issues. So we can mitigate this in the rooms below 32 degrees with installing an insulated floor slab along with floor warming.
Thanks, Jen. Just so everybody on the panel feels included, Tony got one for you too. Mm-hmm. What would be a recommended air change per hour rate to begin to have a difference in the quality of the air to reduce infection rates. We have seen between 1 to 3 air changes per hour in a non-food warehouse.
Yeah, so Dustin Schaefer has done a lot of research on this particular question, and I'm not sure I have the answer for you guys right now, but we can follow up with that. I mean, in normal situations, if we condition the space, we provide the minimum amount of, you know, air outside air required by code. And then we add to pressurize the building and to, you know, have more outside air. If we have louvers and fans, that 1 to 3 mentioned in the question, it's definitely where we want to be. But for infection control, I'm going to have to pass for now, and then we're going to have to follow up later.
Great. Thanks, Tony. And if you look at hendersonengineers.com website, we've got lots of thought leadership pieces related to infection control. So I'd direct you there as well, but we will send that answer out with all our responses.
Yeah, real quick, we are doing a test with a laboratory on that exact thing right now. Oak Ridge Laboratory. And so I think Dustin may already have the answer, but if we didn't, we'll just let you know.
Great. That's awesome. Chris, time for the last question. What is the most common practice for warehouse design? Domestic water and fire sprinkler lines to be shared or separated?
If I'm understanding the question, I'm assuming that they're asking, should you bring in one line into the building and split it inside the building? So I'm going to guess that that's the question. So I apologize if that's not what you're asking. Honestly, it's going to depend upon the local requirement. You can split them inside, but it's going to be a big line coming in most warehouses. So my only concern for the domestic side would be if you brought in a 10, let's just say you brought in an 8-inch as a minimum to support the sprinkler system, that's going to be a very, very, very low flow through that 8-inch for the domestic purposes. And I think you might have some chlorination concerns from the domestic side. So my recommendation would be to not do that. I would recommend bringing in a separate domestic every time because there's going to be such stagnant water on the fire side that it could, you know, create a bit of a disinfection issue for you on the domestic side.
Thanks, Chris. That makes sense to me. And with that, we have quite a few questions we didn't get to. So we'll package those up as well as the ones that were answered by our experts today and get that out to you. And I think we'll also be sending a link to the webinar link to the webinar so you can review this and share it with others at a future date. So we thank you all for the time you've invested today. Hopefully it was valuable to you and maybe you learned something. And we invite you to stay active and participate with us in the future. We plan to do more learning opportunities. So thank you so much. If you have any feedback, please feel free to send. Have a wonderful day.